Right then, you lovely lot. So a nice quick one now of tying your first ever rig in the old wide world ever. Something that I absolutely adore doing, folks, is getting prepared for matching tying rigs. But joking apart, it's something that's got to be done. Dead simple. I've got all the component parts I need first off. So I've got my line. Obviously, I've got my float. I've got my hooks in there. I've got the silicone, which we'll go through in a sec because you've got to be using the right silicone. Pair of scissors, my shot, and my little loop tie thing that I've only just started using because I keep getting shouted at by Jamie. So first things first, I'm going to be covering just a general like pellet rig for fishing in sort of 4 foot of water. So first things first is mainline. I'm going to go for 0.18 AccuPower because this is going to be more so for F1s with possibly the odd carp. Obviously, if it's more carp dominated where you're fishing, folks, just go heavier mainline. 0.18 is what we're going on. So first things first. There's loads and loads of different knots out there, but I'm going to show you a nice simple one. You're getting zoomed in on that Richard. Yes, I'll do everything from here for you. So nice dangly bit of line, and this is the line that's on my spool. So the first thing I want to do is just get around sort of 2 inches of line, if you like, fold that around my finger and then trap it. Yeah, so I've got a little loop there and I've got my bigger loop at the top. Now I want to put this loop through that one. I go through 4 times, folks, because it's a nice strong knot then. You know, excuse you, Richard, did you hear the cameraman then? For honestly, can't get the stuff these days. I go through 4 times rather than twice. So what I'm doing, I'm getting me, it's not my index finger, it's not my middle finger, my little finger. What's this finger called, Rich?
Ring finger.
All right, go on. I generally didn't know that. So I'm getting my ring finger, putting it through there with my thumb, and then I'm just getting that loop, and I'm going to go through 4 times. So 1, 2, 3, and then 4. Now, very important at this stage, you simply must moisten the line. If I just pull that line tight, what happens is the line heats up under pressure and then the potential for snappage there. So just make sure you give it a bit of a moisten and then just pull down nice and tight on that. So you can see there, nice strong knot. Now with this tag end that you've got left over there, I'm just going to snip that off. Make sure any odd bits of line, folks, get rid of it. Don't leave them on the bank. So that's what you're left with. Now, for me, I'd put straight that on my connector, but I'm going to show you a real easy way of releasing the rig at the end. I've got something crawling on my leg. I'm going, what is that? Oh, it's a beetle. Right, so going back up to the start of this loop, so a big loop here. If you just grab that right at the top and then pull about an inch back, push it back on itself, it'll naturally create that loop for you. Now what I want to do is put that loop through that loop 2 times. And all will be revealed later. So we're just going through, I think my big mittens have just masked it there, Rich, haven't they? But I'm just going to go through once and then twice. So that's what you're left with. If you can see that, you know it, Richard? And then literally, you don't need to moisten this. It doesn't need to be a strong knot. Just going to keep your finger and your thumb, your index finger and your thumb on that and pull away. And then what you're left with is that tiny, tiny little loop at the top of your big loop, of your main loop. Now, next thing I want to do with that loop is just cut the loop open. Yeah? I'll explain why. Basically, if you're fishing this rig up to sort of cover or anything, and then that loop goes over a reed or something like that, it'll actually pull the rig off. And we don't want that, folks. That sounds a bit wrong, but you know what I mean. Right, so attaching this. Now, obviously, I'm going to be fishing with this rig. But, you know, if I was doing rigs up at home, I'd just literally just do them on a spool. But I'm putting this straight onto a top kit so I can show you. So first thing I want to do is open that loop up like that. So you see that, Richard? Get that loop open. And then what I'm going to do is get the single piece of line that's going down to the spool and pull that through the big loop. So you can see now that line is sliding. Okay, so the next thing I need to do is connect that to my top kit. Now, obviously, this is where we've talked about these loads. I use this way of connecting, folks. So I've got like just a little knot in my elastic with my bead onto my elastic over the top. Dacrons, you know, plastic connectors, whatever you like to use, just do that. So what I want to do is grab that elastic and then pull on the line. Just make sure that goes over. And I want to make sure that obviously my line is behind me knot. Yeah, so I'm just going to pull that down to the knot And you can see there, that's secured in place. Don't ever worry about it cutting through the elastic. It won't cut through the elastic, that's secured in place. Before I get on to doing the rig though, I just want to show you why I have this bit on the top there. So at the end of your session, when you put, when I put your rig away in a winder, literally all you're doing, grabbing them two bits there and just pulling, and that's how you release it. That's why it's so important that you do trim that loop out at the end, folks, because if it goes in reeds, you're losing your rig. So let me just put that back on there, get back to that, and then next thing I'll do is just pull that bead down. Yes, you can see that, pull that bead down over the knot, and now everything is secure. So everything's behind, yeah, my bead, if you like, so it can't possibly tangle, and it's a real smooth way of fishing. Right, so because I'm using a 412 float, which is a pretty much general purpose, do everything pellet rig for me today, I won't be fishing this deeper than 4 foot. So what I'll do, I'll get my spooler line. These obviously, I've got my depth markers on my top kit, so I'll find 4 foot, which is up there. And then what I'll do, I'll bring my elastic down to 4.5 foot. Now what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna show you actually, Richard. So there's 4 foot, my 48. What I'll do is I'll stretch my line down to there, to the 54 inches. So then I know when I put like my 4 or 6 inch hook length, I'm gonna have a nice bit of line pulled up to float. But generally, you know, I'll be fishing this sort of like, yeah, 3 to 4 foot, something like that, but usually around 4 foot. So that's perfect there. Next thing we'll do, don't bite this bit with your teeth, folks. Obviously you saw me at the other end biting the line with your teeth. With this bit, because we're gonna go through thin silicone, you must use scissors, because what you get, just snip that with scissors, what you get if you're biting it with your teeth, you get a real flat end on your line and you won't always be able to put it through real fine silicone. So that's trimmed off. We get our float. Oh, it's already got rubbers on for us. Go on, that'll do. Slide them off, but I'll show you the silicone that I use anyway. 412 float, nice pellet float. They've got a little ring at the top, or a little eye at the top if you like. So all we're doing is we're putting, I'll swing it around this way so you can see, you're just putting your line through that eye at the top, and then just threading the float on. So slide that up your line, forget about that for now, we don't need that. But what we need to do now is put the silicone on. So when you're doing a rig, folks, don't do it in sort of like a dark room, that sounds wrong, but you know what I mean? You've got to have natural light, or you need sort of like a really bright lamp or something like that so you can see what you're doing, because it can be pretty tricky to put on at times. Silicone wise, I use a 0.2 mil, but 0.3 mil is perfectly fine. You don't really want to be going sort of 0.5 on fine stem floats like these. If the stem was obviously a little bit thicker, which it can be for fishing with bigger baits and shallow water, like the mudline floats for example, or edge floats, then that's when you can use sort of like, you know, 0.5 silicone. Where you're using heavier shots, use a thicker silicone, because it wouldn't matter as much. It's going to take, you know, take your float down through that surface tension. The trouble using a thicker silicone on finer stem floats is what you'll get, when it's flat calm conditions, you'll get your float sticking on the top of the water. So use a finer silicone and it'll go through the water. So I've got my three bits here that I already put on, and it's very, very important that you're using three bits of silicone, folks, yeah? You only want them sort of, well, what? 8 mil or something like that. So the first one we slide on, and then I tend to go short, a little bit longer, and then longer again for your bottom piece. I don't suppose it matters too much, folks, but it's just the way I've always done it. So a dead short one at the top, a little bit longer, and then longer again for the bottom. As I say, it can be a little bit fiddly sometimes, that's why you need nice light. So that's what we've got. Now what I'm going to do now, all I do is put the loop in there, but I'm going to put the actual float on the silicone first so I can show you. So if I leave my hands there, Richard, are you getting zoomed in on that, Rich? If I leave my hands there, mate. Yeah, boy. So got our three bits of silicone there. We're putting our first one on. It goes on so easy, but you can just see how nice and neat that is against the float. You know, it's not obtrusive like a slightly thicker silicone would be. So what we do with that one, that slides right up just under your float, make sure it's lined up with the eye of the float. Then we put our middle one on, and obviously that goes to the middle of the body. Why do we use three bits of silicone? I suppose, reason being, if you just had two on and one broke, the float just wouldn't act the same. So if you had three on and one broke, you know, obviously you could have two on, the float will act completely different. It's nice and stable, but three is definitely the way forward. If it was longer stem, I'd have four on, but that's for another day. And then just put the bottom one on. And what I like to do is just have it so the silicone is just ever so slightly, if you see that, just ever so slightly overlapping the bottom of the float. I don't want it right up there with the stem shooting out at the bottom. Yeah, I just want it slightly overlapping. So top, middle, bottom. Yeah, nice and permanent fix that on the line, but obviously a little bit of pressure on, you can slide it up and down. Right, so coming back down to the bottom of the line. Now this is where I'm going to be putting my loop in. Dead simple, nothing complicated. I always do like a double overhand loop. Yeah, nothing complicated. Similar to the loop that I did at the top of the rig. That's what I'm going to do on this one. So stretch out about sort of 2-3 inches of line, and then grab your loop, and exactly the same thing as what I did at the top. Finger and thumb on that, pull about an inch back, like that, and then push it back on itself, and then it'll naturally create that loop for you. Yes, you see you've got your single loop and then your double loop. Now what I do at this stage here, again, my mittens are going to get involved here, so you might not be able to see, but it's not the same as I did that other loop. I'm going to put it through two times again. So going through once and then twice. I mean, there is devices on the market. Rich and Jay, folks, they've shown me how to use this blooming loop tire thing. I can't use it at all. So I'll do mine by hand and then I get the right size guide on. So this Preston tool, it's bang on. You've got like little numbers on the side. You've got your 12mm, your 15mm, and then the only two that I use really. More often than not, it's always the 12mm one. So what you do, you get the longer piece, that goes through your single loop, and then the shorter piece goes through your two loops. So you can see there, I've got my single loop and my double loop. So I'm putting the bigger piece through there, and then the two loops through that, and that's what you're left with. So pull down nice and tight, and again with all knots, make sure, give it a bit of a moisten. And what you want to do at this stage is just grab them two bits of line, just slide it up just until it pops off. Sorry, folks. And then just give it a little tighten like that. And that's how you create a perfect loop every single time. So every single one is 12 mil. It's just, whether it makes any difference to the fish, folks, I don't know, but it just looks nice, doesn't it? It just looks nice and neat. Now at this stage here, you've got this excess line. Again, you could trim it off by teeth, but I just like to do everything nice and neat at the business end where, you know, where the fish are potentially seeing it. Trim that off with scissors. Yeah, so that's what we're left with. Again, bit of line, get that away. Now, at this stage here, folks, if I was tying this rig up for myself at home, I would put this on a winder and then get on with the next rig, and that's how I store my rigs. I always shut them on the bank, but I want to get fishing, so I'm going to shutten it up as I do it. Now, I know these floats, again, if you get used to a certain pattern of float, I know what these floats take. Now, a 4 number 12s float will take 5 number 9s with maybe a little babby number 10 trimming shot, depending on what size bait you're using. I'm going to be using this with sort of 4mm, maybe 6mm pellets, so I'm going to get 5 number 9s on here, and that'll take that float down with the bait on perfectly to where I want it to sit. So, I've got my shots. Now, remember, because of the way I'm shotting this, I'm going to have like inch and a bit between them. That's why I'm using shot and not stot. So get a few out of my hand. In fact, we'll get five out. There we go. Get five out of my hand. And then your first one wants to go right down towards the bottom of the rig, just resting on the knot there. Rich zooms in on that. Yep. Then all I'm going to do is just bite that on. Obviously, there's style pliers, there's pincers out there and everything like that, you know. When you're doing these at home, one after another, it will take a bit of time up. So yeah, just make sure you use something like that. But for it to be nice and quick, bat them on with your teeth. And then the next one, I'm going to put roughly about an inch and a half away. Put that one on. Next one, exactly the same again. Inch and a half away, nice and simple. Next one, same again. So you're just repeating the process, basically. Just going to get this done nice and quick for you. And I'll show you what we're left with. There we go. So that's five shots on. So if I'm fishing it with like maggots or something, I'd need a number 10 or 11 under the float. But that is the finished rig. Nice and simple. Five number nines on. Shots because of how we've got it shotted. And then the last thing to do is to put your hook length on, which I've got pre-tied, folks. Of course I've got it pre-tied. So, 0.18 mainline on this. Because it's F1s and the odd carp in here, not massive carp, I'm going to go for a 16s hook to 0.13 mainline, which is nice and balanced. So, we'll get one of them out of there. Now, these come 4 inches, which is perfect for me. You know, 4 inch hook length this time of year is all I need. So, get that off the retainer. Now, I want Richard to zoom in on this because, we've been through it loads, folks, but there's a right way and a wrong way of putting these on loop-to-loop. Are you on it, Richard? Yeah, so make sure your hook length, which is this one, goes over your main line. And then get your hook and then put that back through your main line. Yeah, and pull down nice and tight on that. And then what will happen, it will create like a figure of eight, if you like. Pull that nice and tight so it doesn't strangle itself and it just holds lovely and straight. It never kinks off or anything like that. You see how straight that's holding? Perfect for the fish. And that's it, folks. It's not actually. What we need to do, I'm going to come back here and put a back shot on. You know, we're mad about using our back shots. Now, this is where stots come into play. Remember, anything that you want to move on your line potentially, use stots. Anything that you want fixed, use shots. So, number eight is all you need. One or two number eight stots, and that goes roughly four inches above the float, which is there. You on that, Richard? He's on it. 4 inches above your float, and again, just bite that on. So there you see, so we've got the back shot on, so we keep that float nice and stable, and that's our rig finish, folks. Nothing complicated with that whatsoever. It'll take a bit of getting used to, you know, with like the little intricate bits and, you know, tying the loops and this, that and the other, but I definitely recommend getting used to that loop tire that Jay always goes on about. You know, the one with like a little hooky thing on it. I ain't got a clue how to use them, so I'll just do my loop and then put it through that. And you can see how nice and neat it is. It just looks absolutely perfect. Ready to catch fish, which is what I'm going to do now. Yeah!
Right, so we hope you are enjoying the video that you're watching. If not, have just watched. But what we'd also like you to see is the packages that we include for our more technical, informational stuff, where what we can bring to you is all we pretty much know about the technical side and our match-style side of fishing. You are, of course you are in this bit. We have two sides of things. We have the basic package that for $4.99. You can watch us fish live matches, a Q&A every month, and additional stuff from Matty Dawes with live matches and more technical stuff on his side. Or we have the all-access package where you can literally see technical insights, live matches from us, but also from some of the best anglers flipping on the planet. I mean, we treat it as 3 days coaching for us, and we go out and we show you what we're learning for anglers like Darren Cox, Andy Bennett, Des Ship, to name but a few. Well worth a look if you fancy having a little bit more fishing content to watch.